तुल्यन्निजान्तर्गतं पश्यन्नात्मनि मायया बहिर्बोद्भूतं यथा निद्रया यः साक्षात् कुरुते प्रबोधसमये स्वात्मानमेवाद्वयं तस्मै श्रीगुरुमूर्तये नमः इदं श्रीदक्षिणामूर्तये बीजस्यान्तरिवाङ्कुरो जगदिदं प्राङ्निर्विकल्पं पुनः मायाकल्पितदेशकालकलना वैचित्र्यचित्रीकृतं मायावीव विजृम्भयत्यपि महायोगीव यस्वेच्छया तस्मै श्रीगुरुमूर्तये नमः इदं श्रीदक्षिणामूर्तये तस्मै श्रीगुरुमूर्तये नमः इदं श्रीदक्षिणामूर्तये ॐ सहनाववतु सहनौ भुनक्तु सहवीर्यङ्करवावहै तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै ॐ शान्तिश्शान्तिश्शान्तिः सदाशिवसमारम्भां शङ्कराचार्यमध्यमाम् अस्मदाचार्यपर्यन्तां वन्दे गुरुपरम्पराम् ॐ पार्थाय प्रतिबोधितां भगवता नारायणेन स्वयं व्यासेन ग्रथितां पुराणमुनिना मध्ये महाभारतम् अद्वैतामृतवर्षिणीं भगवतीं अष्टादशाध्यायिनीम् अम्बत्वामनुसन्दधामि भगवद्गीते भवद्वेषिणीम् यं ब्रह्मा वरुणेन्द्ररुद्रमरुतः स्तुन्वन्ति दिव्यैस्तवैः वेदैः साङ्गपदक्रमोपनिषदैः गायन्ति यं सामगाः ध्यानावस्थिततद्गतेन मनसा पश्यन्ति यं योगिनः यस्यान्तं न विदुःसुरासुरगणाः देवाय तस्मै नमः देवाय तस्मै वर्स 25 अव्यक्तो यमचिन्त्योयम् अविकार्योयमुच्यते तस्मादेवं विदित्वैनं नानुशोचितुमर्हसि सव्यक्तः since so atma is not an object of a perception because atma does not possess any form, does not possess any color, atma does not have a rupam, or atma is not rupam, either way we can say. Same way atma does not have a sound, atma is not a sound, and therefore well it cannot be become an object of hearing also. And same way other things also, Atma does not have any kind of a touch. Atma is not a touch. Atma is not an attribute. Atma is not which possesses an attribute. We have to tell both the ways. Either of that, if it possesses an attribute, still it can become an object. Right? If Atma has some kind of a sound, then it can become an object of hearing. Or Atma itself is a sound, then also it can become an object of hearing. But it is not so, and therefore, and that's how it is said. Avyaktaha, atma is not an object of perception, and then it is said, I am chintyaha, achintyaha. This atma is not even object of a thought. That also we have seen. Atma is not an object of a inference. We can say, but this achintyaha, and you might have heard the word chintanam. And that's how they always in Shastra they talk about Atma Chintanam. Atma Chintanam means Atma is an object of a Chintanam. Atma Chintanam means what? Atma is object of a Chintanam. And then definitely why Bhagavan says Achintya? then we have to understand this thing that yesterday we could not cover, but we'll see today this part. So Atmachintanam does not mean that you think of Atma with the help of a mind, because what the mind thinks of is always an image. It's an imagination. Definitely, like if you right now, if you are thinking of your parents, suppose they are in India, suppose, and you are thinking of your parents, then definitely the parent, they are there in a physical form in India. They have not entered. Only their image is formed. And therefore, we have to understand this, and whatever we thought of through the mind is basically an image or imagination. And therefore, if you think of a house, your house, well, the physical house which is outside, it doesn't enter into your mind. It is simply image of that thing only enters into the mind. And therefore, like a person thinks of a fire which is there, and then he definitely think of a fire, and that real fire enters into the mind, then definitely the person would not remain. So it is just an image. Basically the mind modifies into that image. That's all. That is we call as a thought. Mind just modifies into that kind of image. That's the only thing. And therefore, whatever you thought of is always an image. It is made by a mind, or it is a imagination, and that is way. If you say I think of Brahman, then what you think of is basically an image or imagination. Then Brahman also will become a object of imagination, kind of a thing. Well, and that is not true. And therefore, we should say, well, Brahman is Achintya. But then you will say, Swamiji, this is this way. Everything is like that. Like when you say other things are also, they are just formed in the mind as an image only. Well, are you saying that like Brahman is Achintya, then other things are also Achintya? No, that is not true. Because like your house, your parents, etc., they also become Achintya. If Brahman is not an object of a thought, because it is just an image, it's an imagination of the mind, then everything I think of is just imagination. My parents are right there in India. My house is right here. My car is here. Everything, and I just in my mind, I definitely form an image. You say whatever is image, basically it is just it's an imagination, and therefore everything becomes imagination. That cannot be. Well, then we will have to find a difference between these two. Even though everything is in a form of an image, still everything could be chintya, which can become an object of a thought, but Brahman cannot become an object of a thought. What is the difference then between these two? Because we always, for worldly things, which are physically there, really there, outside in the world, well, they have a certain form. They have a certain form. And through the, since they have a form, mind itself modifies into that form. So outside whatever is there, we call it as a form, or in Sanskritam it is called akrutihi. And in mind we form an image of it, that's called pratikrutihi. And therefore in our mind we form an image of a thing, and because they have a form, and in our mind we form definitely an image. Well, Brahman is formless. Then how will you form an image? What is formless? Try to form an image in your mind. Well, it is not possible. And therefore, all other things which are really there in the physical world, even though your mind forms just an image only in the mind, but since they have formed, it is all right. Through that image also, we are able to think of the object, because they have a form. Whereas Brahman doesn't have a form, and still you are trying to make it an object of a thought. That is not possible. Definitely it will be purely imagination then. And therefore, whatever has a akruti, whatever has a form, you can form an image. Whatever doesn't have a form, you cannot form an image. And therefore, in that way, Brahman is really cannot become an object of a thought. Even if you try to see, let's forget about even, you know, the Brahman, even the space, you try to make an object of, you try to think of space. You cannot think of a space, because the space which is all pervading, it's all almost formless. Well, in that also cannot become an object of a thought. Same way, Brahman also cannot be object of a thought, and therefore Brahman is achintya. It cannot become an object of a thought. Well, that is, then how will you do Brahma Chintanam, Atma Chintanam? How will you explain that? How will you explain Brahma Chintanam? This person is doing Brahma Chintanam. This person is doing Atma Chintanam. Then if he is doing Chintanam, then he must be Atma or Brahman can become an object of a thought? No, 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 no. Atma Chintanam means dropping the notion of this I am Anatma, etc. I am dropping the notion I am the body, etc. Like you drop the hot potato, better you drop that. And that is what it means. Hot potato is in your hand. You won't wait for someone to tell you that to drop it. You definitely drop it. So Brahma Chintanam or Atma Chintanam, which is a part of the Nididhyasanam, in which you remove this self-confusion. Basically, what you are not that you are trying to negate, you are trying to drop it. And that is what it means. Then the self-revealing Atma is very much there. It reveals. In fact, these your confusions are revealed in the self-consciousness. I mean, that is all this confusion exists in consciousness. And therefore, but since you don't take yourself just as a consciousness, but you take yourself as a body, mind, sense complex, you drop those notions, that is called Atma Chintana, with the help of a teaching, etc., with the help of a Shastra. So that is the only thing we can think of. A self-revealing thing can never become an object of a thought. What is the object of a thought? Must be definitely it is revealed by the thought. And therefore it cannot become a object of a thought. In fact, the whole thought exists in self-existent Atma. Whole thought exists in self-revealing, illumines in self-illumining Atma alone. Through the self, they are illumined. And therefore, basically, it cannot become an object of a thought. It's a very basis of a thought. And therefore, it is not possible. And therefore, Atma is achintya. And then we have said avikarya. Also, we have seen yesterday. So, Atma cannot undergo any change because it is not in time. And also, it doesn't have any attributes to subject itself to change. Either way, you can say. So, all of this has been said about the Atma. Now, by those people who know the Shastra. Well, definitely we have to add this. How can you say about all these things about Atma? Because Shastra describes the nature of Atma like this. And basically, verse number 12 to verse number 25, all is a description of Atma. What is the nature of Atma? And we, with the help of this teaching, we definitely do the correction our thinking regarding Atma. So earlier I thought I was a Karyakarana Sangata, body, mind, sense complex, and then therefore I all the time subject to change, and therefore a mortal, doer, enjoyer, sukhi, dukhi, etc. One moment happy, next moment unhappy, etc., etc. Well, see, it is told here Atma is avikarya, does not undergo modification. And therefore, I have a feeling that I am undergoing all kinds of modification. Right now, Sukhi, then Dukhi, and then right now, Karta, and then Bhokta, etc. All the time, I feel that I am changing. Well, then what is changing? I alone is Atma. That is changing. That's my experience. And Bhagavan says it is avikarya. It does not undergo any change, any modification. Then what undergoes a change? I feel like I am a conscious being. And I am aware that I am undergoing a change. And you say Atma also is a consciousness and it doesn't undergo a change. How will I understand? Yeah, Atma is undergoing a change. Okay, then you take away your statement back. No, Atma is not undergoing any change. So this is how it is. Atma means here Ahankara undergoes a change. Well, Ahankara undergoes a change. Ahankara modifies all the time. Then Ahankara modifies, and how can Ahankara modifies? Ahankara, well, because Ahankara means which has identification with the thoughts of the mind, or which has an identification with the mind, either way. And mind undergoes change all the time. several thoughts, not a single. I mean, every thought is a momentary, and definitely, then I definitely get reflected in the mind and take mind as myself, and therefore I feel that I am undergoing a change. The very I thought itself is revealed by the Atma. I thought exists in Atma. Even in absence of I thought, I remain as a witness. That's my own experience in a deep sleep state, etc. And therefore, so in Sushupti, well, you don't find Atma undergoing any kind of a change. Then you don't exist. No, I exist. Therefore, that shows very clearly what Bhagavan says is this Atma, which does not undergo any change, which is available in the Sushupti definitely with the ignorance. It is available. It is available in his true form, but with ignorance, and therefore you don't know. But there is no change in Sushupti. Well, still you are there, and which experiencing the Sushupti, the deep sleep state. And therefore, definitely that is the reality of myself. Due to identification with the body-mind-sense complex, I feel I am undergoing constantly the change. But that's not correct. So, therefore, all the previous notion about Atma, well, are given up with the help of this teaching. And this teaching is, this is only called Sankhya Yoga. That's a very important portion of the second chapter. And that's a main portion, verse 12 to verse 25. Then Bhagavan said, Shochitum na arhasi, you have no reason for grief. I mean, na arhasi means you do not qualify. You are not qualifying for, and na arhati, if it is there, then it is not proper, we should say. But na arhasi, tvam na arhasi means you do not qualify. You do not qualify to be said, Bhagavan is telling to Arjuna. Because why? Because Atma is not subject to death, and there is only one Atma, not many Atma, and therefore, Atma does not undergo any change. Well, that's how. So, Arjuna had told, Krishna that he was grieving because Bhishma, Drona would die, etc. Then Bhagavan is responding in this way, that Arjuna, you did not qualify for any grief because no one really dies. So, if no one really dies, then what is the use of grieving? People keep going, yeah, even though they disappear, they come back in different forms. Forms will go. Any particular form will go. That no one can save it. Because the thing which is born has to undergo these sixfold modifications, and that is the last modification, is disappearance of that form. That's how it is. Jayate, asti, vardate, viparinamate, apakshiyate, vinashyati. The vinashyati is not a totally disappearance. It's disappearing in a particular form. A particular form will disappear, and it will modify into some other form. And therefore, basically, a form is disappearing. Atma who possesses the form, Atma which is the truth of that form. Well, and that, if it is just a possessor, then also you will have a problem. But the truth, it is just if the form is just an apparent thing. Well, and the truth of this form is basically the Atma, that is one alone and that never dies. So, then Arjuna could have come back, he could have said, I am not really worried about Atma, because Bhagavan is changing the whole topic now. And therefore, we will have to see some background in this. From verse 26, the topic is changing. Arjuna may think that perhaps I am not grieving for Atma, because you all the time, in so many verses you said, na hanyate hanyamane sharira, etc. But then perhaps I may be grieving for anatma. Well, Bhagavan said the grief is useless, because anatma has to be all the, anatma, nature of anatma is anitya. And therefore it cannot be made nitya. I mean that particular form, which is called anatma, body, etc. Well, that is all the time changing, and therefore it is anitya. It is time bound, and the one who, what is the truth of that form, is timeless. That is atma. well, which doesn't undergo any change. So Bhagavan has given this teaching in these 15 verses, what we have seen almost, and still Bhagavan is seeing on his face there is no appreciation of this teaching. Because if you really appreciate it, if you get a clarity, you will automatically, your face will tell. I mean, I'm not telling you here, don't worry. I'm narrating between Krishna and Arjuna. So that's, I'm just clarifying this. Anyway, but so Bhagavan found that, well, he is as though not appreciating this teaching. And otherwise, very, very intelligent person. And it is called even Naravatara. Bhagavan is Narayana and he is a Naraha. And still, how can it be possible that Arjuna is not able to, appreciate this teaching? Then there is the main reason for this is what has been told in these 15 verses, why it has not been appreciated by Arjuna, because his mind is clouded with sorrow and delusion. That's a state of a tamoguna. And therefore, he will not be able to understand those things clearly. Whatever the teaching will be there, well, under this, basically the impulse of this, the delusion and the grief, it's totally clouded. His mind was totally clouded with this. We have seen that when we started Bhagavad Gita chapter 2. Before that, we have seen this background. And therefore, whatever the teaching was given, that's our own experience also. When we are disturbed, and that too highly disturbed, nothing goes in our mind. Otherwise, we are able to appreciate all these things, avikaryaha, achintyaha. It is not difficult for us to understand. But in a certain mode of a mind, we are not able to appreciate. And that mode is basically, it is just a effect of a tamoguna only. And that is shokaha, mohaha, delusion and grief. Then Acharya gives an example. That like a person who is, lustful or a lewd. And then to such a person, when he is having such a kind of a thing, his mental state is like this. When you talk about a particular body for which he or she has a lust, if he say that there is nothing in that, it is all flesh and this and, everything is dirty. From any hole which you enter, it is all anyway, I don't want to say. And if you, whatever you say, it won't enter into his mind. Like a person who is very angry. If you tell this person that, if you become angry, etc., you will lose relation permanently with the person. Years of your effort of maintaining the relation with the person will go away. And you will also suffer later after doing anger, etc. And you will tell many things. Nothing will go. In fact, it may appear in the mood of I'm angry. He's angry and you are giving this upadesha, then definitely he may beat you. So basically, the mental state is very important when you give a certain teaching. Either maybe you are giving a teaching about not getting angry, not becoming lustful, etc. Whatever. It doesn't go in a particular state of mind. Same way here, when Arjuna was having a very much, grief, etc. and a delusion also. Well, in that state, whatever has been told in 15 verses does not enter. And therefore, Bhagavan has to employ a new method. And that's what he is employing here. And they say very beautifully, you see, in fact, we have to think of if a person's mind is not free from the grief and delusion, this teaching will not enter. And unless the teaching will, if the teaching doesn't enter, he cannot be get rid of from the sorrow also. So if the mind is sorrowful, the teaching cannot enter. If teaching cannot enter, then sorrow and delusion cannot go. Then what to do now? So could you follow what I'm saying? Because you can say that if it is like that, Arjuna is sorrowful and this having a delusion, well, the only solution is to give him a knowledge of the self. And that's what is happening. It has been given in 15 verses. Nothing happened to Arjuna. Then how to remove the sorrow? Nothing else in the world can remove the sorrow. There is no other upaya. And then unless he, I mean, assimilates the teaching, this will not, his sorrow will not go. What to do? So this is anyonya ashraya. Unless, this state of mind is there in which there is a moha and shokaha, well, teaching cannot enter. If teaching cannot enter, the shoka and moha cannot go. And therefore, they always give an example of a car in winter, especially the winter of USA. In, you know, the car is car will not start. And if it won't start, then it doesn't set into the motion. It does not come into the motion. It has to start first. But it doesn't start. Then it cannot set into motion. Then what to do? Then the people will, you know, push the car. Few people, two or three people, get together and they push the car for some time. They give an artificial running as though to the car. And then it starts, and then it will...